Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know.
Good morning, friends. Happy Canada Day weekend to each of you. Would you stand together and face our flag as we sing our national anthem?
Oh, okay. you take a seat. I was thinking, how many people didn't look at the words for the first verse of that song, and all of a sudden what do you mean there's a second verse? Everyone all of a sudden has their eyes up. Good morning, my name is Matthew Mordaunt, I'm the assistant pastor here at this church, and I want to say a special good morning to the Video Cafe people who are here in the crowd today. This is what we call the main house, and you're sitting on what's called pews. Aren't they comfortable? It's good to have you all here today. If you are new to our church, we normally have two concurrent services that happen throughout about 10 months of the year, and then for the summer months, we combine into one gathering here in the main house, of course, all at 10:30. I just want to let you know also, if you are new, we would love to know a little bit more about you, and so we have these connection cards in the pew rack in front of you, and if you would take the time, please, to fill them out, we would love that. We'd love to get to know a little bit more about you. And with them filled out, you can put them into the offering basket or bring them to the info desk just out these doors. Or if you want a free gift, I always forget to tell this to the Video Cafe people, but if you want a free gift, you can bring this to the to the Welcome Center just out these doors and to the left. We would love for you to do that. I want to mention one quick announcement here today, which is that our VBS is starting up in just over a week's time. And if you would like to sign up your kids or your grandkids or your neighbors, would you take this out, please? And you can fill that out today and hand it into the info desk. That would be wonderful. There was a discount up until Thursday. And if you didn't fill that in before Thursday, you're going to have to pay the full price now. But that's okay. That's okay. It's not that expensive. And if you would like to volunteer, we'd also love for you to do that, too. So, folks, that's all I have for you today. So why don't you all rise and greet one another. We'll continue in worship.
Well, it is good to be with you again today. And I have a question for you. How many of you grew up singing hymns? Wow, yeah, so did I. So this morning, I hope this is okay with all of you, we have put together a hymn medley. We haven't changed them too much, and I hope that you will sing heartily to our God. Sing all praise to Him.
All praise to Him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave His Son for man to die that He might man redeem.
Yes.
Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
His name above.
His name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more, at God the Father's own right hand, where angel hosts adore.
Blessed be.
Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Oh, yeah, here's the band. Yeah, Redeemer, Savior.
Redeemer, Savior, friend of man. Through and by the fall, you have devised salvation's plan, for you have died for all.
Blessed.
Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Shall never end.
Let's sing.
Death cannot keep its prey. Jesus, my Savior, He tore the bars away. Jesus, bless my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign.
Thank you. Please be seated. often some groups will say, okay, you know, come, tonight we're going to have a hymn sing, and we're going to sing through a few old songs. That was good. Thank you. Welcome this morning. We are delighted to have you here, and it's kind of neat to have everybody together for just about 8 Sundays in the summer before we begin Video Cafe today again. So it's really nice to have you all, and actually on a long weekend, it's nice for us all to be together because it looks like there's some people here. Great to have you here. You know, I'd be interested to know, because we celebrated Canada Day this past week. And I'd be interested to know, how many of you were born outside of Canada? How many of you? Look at that. Let's get an idea of where you were born. Where were you born? Russia. Eritrea. We know it as Eritrea, yes. Australia, England, Mexico City, Malaysia, Taiwan, I can't hear you, Cindy. Poland, yes. Germany, I heard that. South America, Brazil, you said? Brazil? Netherlands, of course. He's only lived here 100 years, and I cannot get his accent still. Ukraine. Yeah. You know, there's one in every crowd, hey? Hungary. Paraguay. Vancouver, I heard that, yes. Netherlands, yes. New Zealand.
Denmark.
Prussia,
Indonesia,
Ukraine, USA,
Germany,
wow, yeah, Copenhagen, Denmark, yes, I know that. One of the beautiful things about Canada is that we come from all over the world, and we find in this place a place to belong. And it's a wonderful country for that. You know, you go to some countries of the world, and most people are from the same background, but we are sort of a cosmopolitan melange of people here. And that's one of the things that we love about Canada. We're going to talk about something like that in a few minutes. But first, I would like to invite the ushers to join me at the front, please, if you would. So we sang a few minutes ago, some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away. And a member of our congregation this past week, flew away. Elsie Nessel from our congregation was in her 102nd year. And she passed away peacefully on the 30th of June. The service to remember her will be Friday, the 8th of July, this Friday, at 2 o'clock at Henderson's Funeral Home. And our condolences to you guys, and bless you. We're going to receive the offering this morning, and as we prepare to do that, we are kind of on the cusp of a number of outreach things this summer. And summer is a great time to have outreach to children and teens through various summer ministries. And those that are associated with our church, you know, Camp Kakawa has a full summer, and there are other Bible camps in our area here. We're going to remember those. Our vacation Bible school is not this week, but next week, and that's going to be a great week, as well as Flow Soccer Camp for our kids, which is a great outreach as well. And we lift up Jesus in all of these times, and children and youth come to know Christ in the summer. That's going to be our prayer. Amen? Amen? So would you join with me as we pray, and then we're going to sing. We're going to sing a song Dustin's going to lead us, and it's a little over 500 years old, and you will find that the words are true and relevant for today as they were when they were penned. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we feel living in our country, even with all of its issues, we feel most blessed. And some of our number who have come from certain places in the world which have been troubled and war-torn are keenly aware and thankful for this country. So Lord, we thank you for the country of Canada, and today we want to pray for those who are placed above us, both in our municipal government and our provincial government and our federal government. We ask, O Lord, that you would guide them, that you would keep our land glorious and free. We ask that in the issues of governance, that our superiors would look to you rather than to the arm of man. So, Lord, be glorified in Canada, and in part be glorified through Chilliwack Alliance Church and its members. And now, Lord, we're going to try and glorify you by lifting up your Son over this next little while. And we want to remember the ministries of the camps in our area. There are many all over, but we think of these ones. And we think of camps like Steelwood and Karis. And we think of Camp Kakawa, with which we have a warm affinity. And we pray, Lord, that there would be safety, that there would be clarity of teaching, that each leader would behave themselves responsibly, and Lord, that many children and youth would encounter the claims of Christ on their life and would enter into relationship with you through your Son. You know, next week we're going to have our vacation Bible school here, and this is an opportunity for us to do the same with children all week. We pray that you'd be with Laura, who is heading up that whole initiative for the first time. We pray that you would encourage her, and we pray that you would do wonderful things through that week. Then we think of Flow Soccer Camp, which Pastor George initiated and which we are carrying on, and which is already full. And we pray that you'd be with Andrew and Carol as they lead that initiative, and we pray that as Jesus is presented, that young people would turn to you and give their lives to you. For we know in this way, you are glorified. So now we have an opportunity to give and to worship in our giving. And we pray that as we give, that you would meet all of our needs according to your riches in glory, and that you would also meet all of the things that you want our church to do for your sake. We pray this expectantly in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand together with us as we sing A Mighty Fortress?
Verse 4.
That word above all.
And all the worshipers said, amen. Amen.
Thank you, everybody. As I was chatting with some of you before the service with our message theme this morning, why do I even come to this church? And you're going, you know, that's right. Why do I even come to this church? Well, I hope I can help you a little bit this morning. Wasn't that a nice feature for our grads last week? It was. I just thought it was great to have our grads telling us where are you headed and how can the church family pray for you as a grade 12 graduate. And this is the season of the year for graduation. We had the Credo School had their graduation here this last week. I think there was 45 grads. They're out of Langley. They come here every year because they just think this is, I think probably because it's the cheapest place, but they think it's the loveliest place. And there were 45 grads, and the house was full this week. So everybody and their grandpa and grandma were here for grads. I've been at, with my wife Carol, we've been at two of our nephews' grad ceremonies in the last month. And you always have a valedictorian, and you also have one of the elite of the whole education system come and speak to the grads who wish they would hurry up, you know. But it's just very interesting to listen to the speeches that are given. And in the speeches, they are encouraging students to break out of stereotypes. You know, they're saying, oh, the world is ahead of you. You know, you just get out there and you defy convention. Go out and be your own person. Don't let the rules define who you are. All that kind of stuff, you know. Mostly it's boilerplate, you know, blah, blah, go ahead, and you're going to be someone special, and, you know, the thing with the word average is most of us are average, you know, but nevertheless, it was really nice. But I thought this, as they were saying, you know, just break free and, you know, shoot for the sky and all that kind of thing. I thought, what are the big hierarchical stereotypes anymore? What are they? What are you supposed to break out of and not to be confined by them? What is the big bad tradition now that we fight against as young people? It used to be that we wanted to rail against the overweight, balding, middle-aged, three-piece suited, anti-women, anti-ethnic, cigar-smoking boss. We wanted to bring him down. And you know what? To a large degree, the baby boomer generation succeeded in doing that. We have succeeded in flattening hierarchy. And I think also hierarchy has been flattened in an accelerated way by the internet. So, you know, you don't have the big ladders to climb anymore, and then you get to the top, and you can wear a three-piece suit and all that. I think that's kind of gone. And so I thought it was a bit hollow for you to rail against all of the institutions that are there, because there aren't that many anymore. In a time like this, where youth are encouraged to go beyond those bounds, and where, in many ways, those bounds have been eradicated or minimized long ago, institutions are left scrambling as to where they fit. They are on a quest for what is the meaning in our organization? What is the relevance of our organization? We've had some debrief from our team that went to the city of Rimouski and just got back this last week, and we have a partnership with the Alliance Church in Rimouski. And so they shared some not hard, cold stats, but anecdotal stats as they were there. There are 55,000, and you know, Quebec in recent past was overwhelmingly Roman Catholic. In the city of Rimouski today, there are 5 evangelical churches, the Alliance being one of them, and they are all in the 50 attendance mark. And as our team was there, they counted 8 large Catholic steeples which were visible as they stood there. And currently in Rimouski, there are 2 Roman Catholic congregations left, and they are in the process of renovating one building and forming one congregation. Small. So that city, which in the 60s was overwhelmingly Roman Catholic, today is overwhelmingly secular. It's quite a thing. In the Rimouski Church, 2 Sundays ago, there were 40 people. And 4 of them were from our church. Church, the institution of church, is not hot in Canada. And denominations even less. So I'd like to talk about our church a little bit this morning and ask, why do I even come here? Today, you are sitting in a Christian and Missionary Alliance church. Who are we? What are we about? I'd like to talk about that for a few minutes. So, a pastor friend of mine had a church on Vancouver Island, an Alliance church, plant. And they were meeting in a school. And so they would set up the chairs every Sunday. And they had a sandwich board that they'd put out on the sidewalk for people walking by. And it said, "Welcome to the Alliance Church." So my friend is standing by the sign one Sunday morning, and 2 boys ride by on their bicycle. And they see the sign, and they put on the brakes. And they are staring agog at the sign. So my pastor friend started to engage them in conversation and said, "Can I help you at all?" And the boys said to my pastor friend, "What is an alien's church?" So, nice to have all you ETs in the balcony there. Last Sunday was really a remarkable Sunday. For those of you who were here, I think it was a really remarkable Sunday. For me as your pastor, and for those of you who weren't here last week, we talked a little bit about where does renewal start. And a renewal really starts not with some kind of a big tornado that flows through your church and knocks everybody over, but renewal really starts with me. It starts with you. And so we just came forward and we indicated that. And so it was just an amazing service. You can ask people about it. But you know what it told me as your pastor? It told me as you responded, many of you by coming down to the front and many of you silently in your seat. It told me that there is a hunger here for spiritual vitality. So let's talk about what we're about, because if we want to be used by God in this non or anti-institutional time, how is God going to do that among us, and how do we try to live that out in our church? So I'd like you to take your Bible and go to the book of Matthew, chapter 28, if you would, page 743 in the Pew Bible if you don't have yours with you. We're going to look at the last few verses to begin our time. As I talk a little bit about the Christian and Missionary Alliance as a two-pronged plug. We're a two-pronged plug. So Matthew 28, verse 16 to 20. For those of you who have been to Israel, I believe this was at Mount Arbel. Mount Arbel overlooks it's the highest mountain overlooking the Sea of Galilee. And it says in Matthew chapter 28, Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. Mount Arbel overlooks the Sea of Galilee. It overlooks the Decapolis, which was pagan area, 10 cities. It overlooks the Jewish area of Galilee with Capernaum and Bethsaida and Chorazin and Magdala and all of these Jewish places. It overlooks the Via Maris, which was the highway from Persia to Egypt, and it was one of the busiest traversed places. In other words, I believe at the top of Mount Arbel, Jesus had these disciples look over their world, the pagan world, the devout Jewish world, and the wider world as they went up and down the Via Maris. And he said, when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. This is the resurrected Lord. And then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded to you, and surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age, Jesus said. This was Jesus' challenge to his followers, of which you, if you're a Christian today, you're his follower, of which you and I are a part. And Jesus' challenge to us is all about disciples. All about disciples. So we ask the question as we read Jesus' challenge with him thinking about the world, both near and far, we ask the questions, am I a disciple? Am I a disciple of Christ? And the second question is, am I in the disciple-making business? This was extremely important to Jesus. It is involvement with this quest to both be a disciple and to reproduce disciples that, as Jesus said, brings his personal presence and his accompanying power. If you want spiritual vitality in your life, I would suggest to you that you need to be a disciple. And you need to be in the disciple-making business because it will bring the presence and power of Jesus in your life. It's a promise. So our founder, Albert Benjamin Simpson, in the mid to late 1800s, interacted with this commission. We call it the Great Commission. And he asked these questions of himself, and then he began to ask the questions wider. Am I a disciple, and am I in the disciple-making business? He was a Canadian, but he was living in the States. And so he began to pull like-minded people together, remaining in their respective denominations, around these two questions. And he would call them together around the disciple issue. It was called the Christian Alliance. He formed a society called the Christian Alliance. And he pulled them together around the whole issue of being a disciple. And then a second organization that he put together called the Evangelical Missionary Alliance was about making disciples. And he called people from all over North America to engage with him in this. And he formed these two societies. They published magazines. They were for like-minded people. They published magazines. They held conventions, they sent missionaries, they had prayer events, they had money events over these two questions. And people began to meet together in what we call branches. And they would say, look, you know, there's 40 of us in Chilliwack and we believe in these two things. So why don't we have like every 2 weeks, let's get together and let's have a prayer meeting for discipleship, both ours and overseas. And so they began to meet together in branches, and these evolved into churches. That's why we're in an alliance church today. We were not started as an alliance church. We were started as two individual societies around these two questions of disciple. And so the whole thing began to grow, and in 1887, by the way, was the year that Coca-Cola was invented. It was the year that the phonograph record player was invented. And it was the year that the elevator was invented. We just stayed in a hotel on the weekend on the 23rd floor, and I was thankful for 1887. That year in 1887, our founder put these two societies together, the Christian Alliance and the Evangelical Missionary Alliance. He put them together and he called it the Christian and Missionary Alliance, 1887. And he described what he had put together this way. It is an organization to promote a deeper spiritual life among Christians of all denominations and a more aggressive missionary work in neglected fields at home and abroad. This was 1907 that he said that. So today we're called the Alliance Church because that is what we are. We are an alliance of people gathered around the disciple question of Jesus' Great Commission. Am I a disciple? And am I making disciples? The deeper Christian life and a heart for lost people. These are our two main values. And at Chilliwack Alliance Church, and somewhere in your bulletin, it will say, we call it growing deep and reaching wide. That's what we're about. So this sort of two-pronged plug is what has pulled together people from all denominations. My dad, who was an Alliance pastor, grew up a Norwegian Lutheran. Anybody grew up Norwegian Lutheran? Okay, there you go. And then when my grandfather was saved, they moved and became Pentecostal. So my dad was Norwegian Lutheran come Pentecostal. My mother was raised Mennonite Brethren. So I did a quick head count of our staff and our elders at this church as far as our backgrounds are concerned denominationally. And on your staff and elders board, you have people who grew up Mennonite Brethren, Roman Catholic, Evangelical Free, Pentecostal, Presbyterian, nothing, Baptist, and Anglican. That's the background for our people. And you know, there's an occasional Alliance thrown in there, and that's me. We are from all over the map. But we come together on these two issues. So around a core doctrinal statement, we tend to be very pragmatic on gospel issues. You'll see here that we try not to fight about slivers of doctrinal stance because it's really not who we are. So let's talk for a couple of minutes, a few minutes, about these two main values. And so let's talk about the Christian Alliance, which is the deeper part. Am I a disciple? And let's go to the book of Galatians chapter 5, page 868. Page 868 in your pew Bible, Galatians chapter 5. And we'll look at verse 16 in a moment. So if you read the first chapter of Ephesians, verse 14 of Ephesians chapter 1, it tells us that every Christian has the Holy Spirit inside. Every Christian has the Holy Spirit inside. He is a deposit, Paul says, guaranteeing our eternal inheritance. It's because Elsie Nessel accepted Jesus and the Holy Spirit came to live in her that we know where she is today. He was the deposit in her life that guaranteed her eternal inheritance, the Holy Spirit. So if you are if you have put your trust in Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit inside of you. His main job, if I can do a gloss, his main job is to make Christ real in your life. To sensitize us to sin and to point us to Jesus. So we read what the Holy Spirit does in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. It says this. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. So if you're struggling with sin in your life, then this is a key for you. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the spirit, and the spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other so that you do not do what you want. But if you are led by the spirit, you're not under law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's what the Spirit wants to produce in your life. Who embodies these qualities the best? Jesus. Jesus. That's what the Spirit wants to produce in your life and mine. That's the deeper part, am I a disciple, that we're talking about now. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. So when we become a Christian, we have all of God. When you accept Jesus as your Savior and Lord, you have all of God. You have all of the Father, all of the Son, all of the Holy Spirit. But typically, He does not have all of you. And Christians normally will come to that place in our life. If we're going to take the discipleship question seriously, we're going to come to that place in our life when we say, I can't live the victorious Christian life on my own. For me to be like Jesus, I have to let the Holy Spirit do His work in my life. And rather than keeping Him as simply a deposit or a get out of jail free card, I'm going to let Him have His way. I am going to allow the Holy Spirit to take the steering wheel of my life and begin to drive my life and drive me toward Jesus. And so we call that a crisis in our life. And we say, you know what, Holy Spirit, you've got to help me in this thing. You've got to help me be like Jesus. We do that at a crisis, and then we do it every day for the rest of our life. We say, Holy Spirit of Jesus, have your way in my life today and help me to look more and more like Jesus. It's the deeper Christian life. We call it progressive sanctification. We call it holiness. We call it Christ-likeness. And let's go just over to the book of Romans, just over to your left, chapter 8, page 841. It describes what the life in the Spirit looks like compared to just going our own way and keeping the Holy Spirit just kind of locked up in the closet. Romans 8, verse 5 says this, page 841. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what the nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man and woman is death. But the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. So the sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who lives in you. It's our decision as a Christian which way to go. We can keep the Holy Spirit just as a ticket, or we can allow Him to take the steering wheel and make us more and more like Christ. It's our decision. And our founder called it spiritual breathing. This is a wonderful concept that I've talked to you before about. Spiritual breathing is just like physical breathing, where you and I inhale and exhale thousands of times a day. Some of you do less so, especially in church. But normally, we inhale and exhale. You breathe out that which is spent, and you breathe in that which is fresh. It's what keeps us alive. And that's how we have the deeper Christian life. That's how we walk in the Spirit. When we sin, we confess it. And we say instead, Holy Spirit, come in afresh. Have your way afresh. So we don't wait, you know, to pile up a whole bunch of sins all day, and then we stagger to our bedside and pour them all out and realize what a terrible person we are. That's Satan's way. He would love to browbeat you. No. When we fall, we confess it, we get back up again, and we continue the Christ walk. It's called spiritual breathing. We keep short accounts with God, and it increasingly makes us look like Christ's character. It is called the Spirit-filled life. We are growing deeper in God. The New Testament is far more concerned with this concept than it is in church about programming and methods in the church. The New Testament is concerned with us resembling Jesus Christ, and it was this kind of living that turned the pagan world of the New Testament on its ear and turned it to Christ. This kind of thinking is what crumbled the Roman Empire spiritually and raised Christianity in the then known world. It was real people walking toward Christ through the course of their life, and this in the Alliance is what we are about. Being a disciple. If you want spiritual vitality in your life, then you need to be earnest about letting the Spirit have His way and being a disciple. Now let's talk let me just say this. We have this logo up here, Savior, Sanctifier, Healer, and Coming King. We describe this Christ focus as the fourfold gospel in the Alliance Church. So we look to Jesus as our model in salvation. He gives us new life. So we enter into relationship with God through Him. We embrace His gift of eternal life, and we do all we can to introduce others to it as well. We seek a holy walk with Christ. We are in the process of sanctification or becoming holy, living a holy life. We walk with Him, and we resemble Him more in our thoughts and actions. We look to Christ for His enabling to fulfill God's calling in our life. We believe that as we do that, that God will empower us and sometimes even physically heal us in order for us to fulfill that mission. We believe that physical healing is tied to discipleship. It's not so that you can once again get on your motorcycle, although that might be a spin-off of it. We believe that healing is tied to being a disciple. And we look for Christ, the coming King, to return for us at a moment that we aren't sure of, knowing that we will be with Him forever. This is how we describe the Spirit-filled life. That's where we're headed. That's what we're about, is the fourfold gospel. Now, that's the first prong of the plug. That's the deeper part, the Christian Alliance. Now, let's talk about the wider part. That's the Evangelical Missionary Alliance, or the wider part. So the problem is that if you only go deep, then you begin to stink. You know the difference between a lake and a slough? Anybody? Hello. A lake, you have a stream going into the lake, and you have an outlet going out of the lake, whereas a slough is something you dig with a backhoe, and then you let the rain fill it, and then it stagnates until it goes dry. And if we only go deep, then we tend to stagnate. We begin to stink. And you'll get people who know all kinds of stuff about the Bible. They can parse it. They know their Greek and all that kind of stuff. But you don't want to be with them somehow. What is that? It's because they've only asked one of the two questions. Am I a disciple? The second question is, am I in the disciple-making business? We need an outlet for our personal walk with the Lord. Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 14, "And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then what? Then the end will come." We believe that we can hasten the coming of God's kingdom by our disciple-making efforts. The Early Christian and Missionary Alliance in North America started orphanages, homes for people seeking healing, homes for prostitutes wanting to leave the streets. We did a lot of that kind of work. Our first alliance footprint in Canada, west of Winnipeg, was in Vancouver, and it was called the Vancouver City Mission in 1905. It was built near the docks in Vancouver to work with the seamen who came and went, and then they also held services there. So the early alliance did a lot of work in disciple-making in the local setting in North America, but we also sent missionaries overseas. Interesting stat, Pastor Matt grew up in the oldest Alliance Church in Canada. He grew up in First Alliance Church in Toronto, Ontario. And the First Alliance Church sent their first missionaries to China in 1880. And I read the list of the missionaries that that church has sent up until the book was written, which was probably the mid-90s, and they had probably sent 100 missionaries out of that church. So we, in answering the question, are we in the disciple-making business, in the beginning, we did a lot of local outreach, and then we did a lot of global outreach. We call it today being missional. Being missional. Having a heart for lost people both near and far. So we think about having a heart for people who are near. Some people think about evangelism as kind of for special people at special times in special places. You know, you kind of hire an expert, and then they bring in the sheaves for you, and then you pay them a salary, that kind of thing. And it's not so at all. It's not so at all. Evangelism or outreach is every Christian asking the Holy Spirit to use them in people's lives so that Jesus can be seen. You know how we have concept around here that different groups will adopt a section of road, you know, and they just sort of, they look after that road, so, you know, they... You know, Kiwanis or whatever, they'll adopt 2 kilometers of road, and then, you know, a few times a year they'll go and pick up all the garbage that you threw out, you know, and all your cigarette butts and all that, and they'll pick it all up, and they'll just keep it nice. It's a great concept, actually. And in the whole issue of the discipleship world, we call it being a chaplain. Being a chaplain. A chaplain is someone who assumes spiritual responsibility for a group of people, for an area in which they have some influence, or in which they sense God is calling them to. And we have talked to you about this concept, and we have adopted around our church a parish. And it's a bounded area. The edges are a bit fuzzy on that, but when we spend money in local outreach, we try to do that. We try to spend that money first in this parish, this local area. And Carol Goh from our church is a few hours a week, and she manages our parish outreaches. We're trying to make a difference in our neighborhood so that And part of our dream is for our neighborhood here that when people from our neighborhood who may never come to this church drive by, they say, I'm glad that church is here. We're trying to be a chaplain, and I would commend this as a doable way for you. You may live in an apartment building, and it's a place that may have 10 suites or it may have 50 suites, but that apartment building, if you will let it, can be your mission field. It can be a place where, and you don't have to be obnoxious about it, but you can pray for the people there. You can be interested in the people there. And you can be a light for Christ in your area of influence. It could be at your work, many different ways. We take spiritual responsibility for that which is close to us. It's a way to make the disciple-making business practical. But not only near, but also far. It's not enough just to have a vision for our city, a dinky little city like Chilliwack. It's pretty small if that's all of our vision entails. We lift our heads higher to see the world. So this past week, I went on the population clock. Any of you ever been on the population clock? Man, if you're an entrepreneur, it spells opportunity. If you're a doomsdayer, then it spells doom. As of this past week, there are over 7.4 billion people in the world. And so far, in 2016, our world population has grown by 41 million people. It's outpacing, births are outpacing death. 41 million people? That's larger than the population of the entire Canadian nation. We've grown by that many people. Are we going to lift our heads higher to the world? Because each of those people has a soul. And each of those people matter to God as much as you and I matter to God. Will we take that seriously, or will we just sort of let it wash off like water off a duck's back? One of the beautiful things of living in this day is that technology enables us to touch so many. So we are a missionary society. The Christian and Missionary Alliance is a missionary society. We send high-quality people, and we do so in a few different ways. We have what's called here a global advance fund. So when you give and you have an offering envelope there, we pay all of our missionaries. They don't have to come and beg you for $10. We pay all of our missionaries, and we do so through the Global Advance Fund. By the way, our church is in the top 10 of global advance giving in the country. So I thank you for that. It helps us to send quality missionaries. We give them language training, and we give them cultural training so that when they go, they can relate to the culture they are being sent to. And typically, the Alliance overseas specializes in church planting, compassion ministries, and theological education. So in our church, as far as disciple-making is concerned, you will see us repeatedly trying to do outreach things. Some of them fail spectacularly. And some of them have been awesome. We spend a lot of money on trying to be friendly to our community and also trying to do missions engagement. And, you know, we're involved, as has been mentioned, with Camp Kakwa and Vacation Bible School and Flow Soccer and Five Corners Christmas and Remembrance Day Outreach and Parish and Ruth and Naomi's and Foreign Missions. It's kind of what we're trying to do. So as I close today, we have a two-pronged plug. That's all we're about. We ask the question, am I a disciple? And we ask the question, am I in the disciple-making business? Our founder said, the mission of the Alliance has ever been extremely simple. It is to make the Lord Jesus Christ real and encourage his people to receive him in all his fullness and give him speedily to the lost world. So a church in this in this non-denominational, non-hierarchical time, this time when church is seen in increasing ways as perhaps irrelevant. I still think the local church is the hope of the world. But we're in a non-institutional time. And you know, so people come to church for different reasons, and certainly a church is a social organization. But we believe that true belonging in the church is found in obedience to God, going deeper, and strategic engagement in mission, going wider. We think that's where true belonging comes from. The Lord has a calling on your life in those two questions. And I believe that this is a place where you can live out that calling. Invest yourself in the deeper life and then in service to those in the church and outside the church. I believe this is the adventure of the Christian life. To be the man or woman or young person that God wants me to be, so that as I walk through my life, I look more and more like Jesus. That's an adventure. Holy Spirit, what do you want me to do today? But also to cultivate a heart for people who don't know Jesus yet and be involved in others rather than to want everything for myself. Lord, what do you have for me today? It could be anything. It could be anything. There are today in the world 4.5 million Alliance people in 13,000 churches in 81 countries of the world who are asking these questions. They are a pragmatic, earnest, engaged group, and you are part of that. Will you jump in? We're gonna close by singing, and I'd like to invite the band to come up. Last Sunday, we had a response for spiritual vitality, and we largely, as a congregation, said, "I'm in. God, do something in my life. I am ready." So today, I'm giving you a means to do that. There are many wonderful things that happen in a local church. You develop great friendships. Some of you meet your wife in the church, and you know your wife-to-be. Praise God. Laughter, fun times, free hot dogs, good music, great programming, poignant moments. The church means a lot of things, a lot of things. Thank you. If you mean that I'm part of that, I don't know. So there are many things that a church means to us. But at its core, we have a vision to grow warmly mature in Christ and to reach out to lost people strategically. We come and go in our effectiveness in this, but it's what we're about. And I am calling you, as a people who told me last Sunday, we're in. I am calling you afresh to engage in this vision. Be pragmatic as you think about being a disciple. How could I grow in Christ this summer? What things could I do that would help me to grow as a Christian? If you've been spinning your wheels for a long time, you're a thinking, sentient human being. You're not an animal. You can make some decisions that will take you to God. I say, do them. Do them. And then ask, what steps this summer could I take to cultivate for a heart for my neighbors and for my world? What could I do? What could I do to put myself in a place, a usable place for God to use? And you may find, regardless of your age, regardless of your Christian experience, that you are on an adventure that you had no idea you'd ever be on. So, brother, sister, engage in the two questions that Jesus left us with before he ascended to the Father. He said, be a disciple. And be a disciple maker. And if you will do that, lo, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. May it be. So we're going to stand together, if you would. We're going to sing just a great song, and it's talking about, you know, ancient words. It's the song "Ancient Words," ever true, changing me, changing you. May I commend these ancient words of Jesus to you, given over 2,000 years ago. I think they are totally relevant today. Let these ancient words work in your soul. Let's sing this song together. Hierarchical denominational church is out. Is out. But church is full of people who are walking in the Spirit and loving lost people are absolutely smoking hot. I want our church to be smoking hot. How about you? as ever, the people of God who walk with God and love others around them will experience the personal presence and power of Jesus to the end of the age. Next Sunday, you know, there's a lot of things that Bible-toting evangelical Christians don't like as to what's happening in our culture. And next Sunday, I want to ask this question. Can I be and live a victorious Christian life in the midst of a pagan culture? Can it actually happen? And I'm going to take you back 2,000 years. We're going to have a little bit of an archaeological talk next Sunday about the third largest city in the Roman Empire and what God did there through a bow-legged bantam rooster called the Apostle Paul. And we're going to see what happened in that city. And it's a rhetorical question next week. Can you live a victorious life? Yes, you can. And not only can you live a victorious life, but you can put a culture on its ear. Next Sunday. I hope you'll be here. But first, let me bless you in prayer, and then we'll go our way. Heavenly Father, we began this service today by singing, O Canada. And we sang, Ruler Supreme, who hearest humble prayer, hold our dominion in thy loving care. Help us to find, O God, in thee a lasting rich reward as waiting for the better day we ever stand on guard. As our country moves inexorably away from its Christian values, which has made it great, would you make us the people who are winsome, warm, loving, and visionary to maybe recreate what happened in the early church? Now, for each person here today who desires spiritual vitality, as they interact with these two questions, am I a disciple and am I in the disciple-making business, Holy Spirit of God, you who reside in every Christian, would you speak? Would you do something God-sized in each willing heart this week? Maybe an opportunity, maybe a conviction, maybe a word from God, maybe a scripture that jumps out. Because we want to be where you are moving in the world. And we want that to be here. So bless my friends today, Lord, as they go their way, and some will be traveling and some are visiting here today. I pray your blessing wherever they are, that they would know that you are with them. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, everybody. See you soon.